And the really interesting thing for me is, can you, and I also have a picture in my mind of a candidate, but maybe it's a board of directors as well, for the organization, saying, okay, we're trying to in cabinet table, we're looking after health systems, we have to sort out national economic plans, we have to sort out a national strategy for conservation. So is there a means of using as a common element, a framework that's common to all of those challenges, all of those tasks as a cabinet, a means of using a single framework that is based upon a simple set of principles that come together to give you resilience. And then if the health track and the economic policy track and the environment track are following this common framework, how, using this common set of principles, how does that to get better overall resilience for national development or for an organization and decisions the board is for to make?
I agree, and I would like to introduce my favorite innovation, namely the Ministry of Productive Landscapes, which is exactly this. We recognize that what we are dealing with are problems that cut across sectors that are impossible to solve within one sector. If we were to look at the landscape as an entity or a watershed, and we would then combine the ministries of environment, agriculture, forestry, tourism, and maybe one element that has explicit responsibility for human, for wellness, and take that kind of approach. It sounds funny, but I think it's something that we need to think in those terms of that, be able to institutionalize cross-sector work, otherwise we won't be able to succeed.
Yeah, Johan and Jorgen, I suppose you to answer this question, but you must have come across a lot of examples where perverse laws or perverse policies actually push communities away from resilience, don't allow people to do things that make them resilient. Would you like to reflect on that, perhaps, Joe first? How do you deal with perverse policies and laws?
The experience I have had just at the level of government, this is really complicated. Because what you do, in fact, is just collect information and then feed it to the government. But the question of perverse incentives is, you know, it's so debated that it's not very clear to me usually. So I find it difficult to answer the question.
If you're happy, David, a few words, and we'll go straight down the panel, and you can can answer that question, but also if you have any closing comments that you would like to make.
How good are we? I'd like to say we're not very reformed, but we're getting better. Some places are better than others. It's a question that deserves more than the sort of short answer I'm going to give. I think that when faced with a crisis, some communities respond rather better than others. I think communities that know each other, where people trust each other, are able to respond to crises rather better than those where there's most newcomers. Traditional communities often do have some kind of inbuilt institutional memory, community memory, allows them to use traditional knowledge and apply it to the new circumstances. Communities that are made up of migrants who are living in a place that they're not familiar with are a much more tricky situation. A lot of farmers who have been moved to a new place and over a lifetime found the farming systems that brought with them don't work are often in a very tricky situation and they're able to respond to that.
Yeah, thank you. Keep cutting right to the core of it, I think. In resilience terminology, we recall that kind of situation a poverty trap. And anybody who's worked in development will have a very good understanding of poverty and how difficult it can be to change it. One of my hopes is that resilience theory will help us get a better understanding of poverty traps and find better ways of dealing with them. I'll just comment by saying that the kinds of work that your organisation is doing and all the presentations that I saw today, they're all about dealing with this question of poverty traps. So I mean, it's just a case of learning through doing and building on the experience and learning how to do it better.
Thanks. What we are talking about, the kinds of requirements that we see are important, also are about a way of describing societies that function very well, where there is open discourse, where there is broad participation in processes leading to decisions, where authorities are prepared to take risks because they know that the citizens actually trust them, which is also an element of learning. But we know that there are not many societies that are like this, and we need to understand, that's why we need to think very comprehensive, broad approach to this, particularly recognize that the most vulnerable societies now are those that are in conflict, in internal conflict, and these are the kinds of societies that are absent from the kind of conferences that we are now engaging in. To understand the importance of social cohesion, sort of shared values, the ability to negotiate and agree, these are absolutely fundamental aspects of resilience.
I've been thinking about during the session and also outside of it, what's the pathway to using this kind of the theory and the emerging knowledge about what helps build resilience? What's the pathway to using that in policy? And I found in this session thinking about three things. One is having this common set of principles or keystones that form the basis for packages of activities that integrate social and natural economic. And I think the presentations we've seen give us examples of that. And having then a means to ensure that policy dictates or encourages that you bring together those packages when you're implementing. And ensuring that, the second point is ensuring that a policy is explicit about setting up and recognizing the importance of working across scales and having the right institutional setup, the right institutional responsibilities, the right activities at different scales. And then the third point is this, several people have gone back to the point about learning the community. And I think we're pretty comfortable with the idea of learning from the ground, as you've seen in the cases. But I think we're not yet ready, or we don't yet feel that we're sure how to take this stuff to the much higher policy levels, much higher level policy forums, where people that make the real decisions, just talk about them, people that make the real decisions will recognize that here's a useful set of tools and I'm prepared to start using them. I wonder how we get to that.
Thank you. I just want to point out that maybe at this stage you have to stress information exchange, information gathering, and also capacity building. When Donald asked the question, I just wanted to ask him to answer the question himself because he has a lot of experience working at that level, and certainly he has a lot to convey to us.
Thank you. I apologize to everybody who said that we had to cut it short and allow other people wanting to ask questions. The good thing is when we're at Congress, we have a captive audience, and I'm sure that our panelists will be more than happy to meet with you outside of this room. I'll just give one of my own experience, some probably 10 or 12 years ago, trying to get an issue into a UN space. That issue was around forest landscape restoration, and at the time, Stuart McGuinness, who is with IUCN at the moment, at the time was with WWF, and I was in IUCN. We were in a UN forest meeting, and we brought up the concept of forest landscape restoration. Immediately afterwards, we were approached by a delegation, I won't say from Nigeria, but that delegation told us in no uncertain terms that we would never bring that issue into a UN meeting ever again. And if they did, they would make sure that we were banned from the meeting. That issue is now widespread in UN documents, including in the CDD. So there's a concept from resilience about moving, I think, applicable to how to get lessons into policy, and that's the concept of persistence. So we did persist over 10 years to get that in there. But we also use sound evidence, so we make sure we brought voices from the field to future UN meetings about what it meant for communities, what it meant for developing countries, and why this was a necessary thing. And we went in, made it practical, and we built a coalition around that to force those issues onto the agenda and to be discussed. So it can be done, you have to be patient. I think I'd like to ask you to join me, thank yourselves for the audience, but also our wonderful panelists that put a lot of work into this, fantastic concepts and ideas, some great frameworks, and hopefully you'll take home some of these ideas and think about how you can apply them. Thanks very much.